I hope to kill the phrase death by PowerPoint in this video, because I'm gonna share three really cool examples on how to make a PowerPoint presentation more interactive that I have actually used and help clients, specifically Crayola, Johnson & Johnson, and a really lovely university, help make their presentation, their content more engaging. And if you stick around to the end, I'm gonna share a bonus optical illusion that might blow your mind. That would be really fun to insert as well. I'm Chad Littlefield, let's get into it. First technique is really simple. I taught this to Crayola, who is a client of mine, and I was working with one of their teams to make their presentation more interesting. This was a quality assurance group, and they sent me the slide deck. It was like 54 slides long. It went deep. It was lots of very technical information. It was not the kind of stuff you like to read on a Sunday morning to relax. And so we really wanted to spice up and make this presentation more interactive, so that people did not just totally tune out and go to their inboxes or be somewhere else. It was gonna be delivered remotely, which matters, not a ton, but it does matter in terms of the context. And here's what I did, and here's what you can do the second this video ends. Before I looked at any of the specific content, I scrolled to the bottom and noticed that there were 54 slides, and I said, before I dig in at all, you know, we're gonna come up with some specific ways to make specific content pop and a little bit more interactive. But right off the bat, I inserted a blank slide roughly every 7 slides. And I said, all we need to do to make this more interactive is either on the slide right before or the slide right after, do something to invite contribution, not consumption. PowerPoint is a pixelated rectangular box purely designed for consumption. It was invented long enough ago that it hasn't totally adapted to our attention spans. So sure, you can make a PowerPoint interactive by having some animations come in, or that's not like really deeply engaging. I'm talking about deep engagement that makes people wanna lean in, participate, actually be a part of the content that's being shared. You came to this video, though, not for me to just say, insert a blank slide every 7 slides. You came to this video to know what goes in those blank slides to make it more interactive. So a handful of examples. If you're not subscribed to the channel, there are millions of other examples across the channel, but collaborative journaling, where you give everybody designated time to write in the chat or on a sticky note and reflect on what they've got so far, or what is sticking out to them about the slide, and then pair up, share, get into breakouts, etc. Or not get into breakouts, just hit enter and spend another minute reading through the chat. So a little collaborative journaling. You could do a quick thumbometer, just assessment, or a Likert scale on a scale of 1 to 10. How are you doing right now from an energy standpoint? How are you doing from an interest in the content standpoint? Just a little bit of a check-in there. Whether you're in person or remote, Googling. We have these crazy, I don't have it in my pocket, but we have these crazy computers in our pocket that access all information on Earth, kinda. And so you can invite a group to say, hey, this is what we're gonna be talking about. Before I tell you anything about it, can you spend 2 minutes Googling, travel down the rabbit hole, and try to learn a fact or something interesting about this idea or topic that you think nobody else will find? So maybe you even go to page 2 of Google, skip past all the big companies that paid a lot of money to be on the first page, and go to that second page, find something that no one else might know, and then we get back together and you popcorn a couple of those facts out. You're educating a group. Now, you know, you wanna check your sources a little bit there so that you're not spreading misinformation in a group, but inviting a group to Google, really cool technique. You could search YouTube and my name for the Wikipedia game. I didn't invent it, but it's a really cool way to mix things up. So many other ideas on the channel. The idea really, though, is take a little pause in your content to do something that invites contribution, even if that is just sitting there in silence for 60 seconds so that everybody can take a couple breaths. That is actually more interactive than you just barreling through 54 slides, hoping that people are actually awake and paying attention. Second idea comes from Johnson & Johnson, a client of mine who I used to deliver this captivating communications course to. And it was all about how to take a presentation and make it more engaging, more captivating. One of the stories we would tell in this presentation was about an executive or an Imagineer at Disney named Joe Rode. And he had gone on a safari, or legend has it, or story has it, I haven't met Joe, went on a safari and was so captivated by the experience, immersive, being that close to you know, a fully grown male African lion, etc., that he wanted to, he got inspired to create Animal Kingdom. And so he could have done a PowerPoint presentation about his safari trip. Look at all this, look at all this, look at all this. But instead, he brought a 400-pound fully grown Bengal tiger into the conference room and had it laying on the table when all the other executives walked into the room. They broke ground on Animal Kingdom pretty quickly after that, right? And so the idea here is that sometimes in order to make PowerPoint more effective, you need to go 3D. You need to bring something physically into the space. So, you know, you picture Steve Jobs pitching a laptop computer to a bunch of engineers who are used to building these big clunky iMacs. And instead of saying, I'd like a more compact computer, I'd like to shrink this down, he takes a 120-page lined notebook and throws it on the table and says, fit all of this into this. Go, right? When you go from 2D to 3D and then back to 2D and then back to 3D and you oscillate between there, it creates this little heartbeat and rhythm that makes the experience much more immersive than if you just live in the background. One of the things we would say in this Captivating Communications course was inviting people to use slides as wallpaper, not slides as the hubs of information, right? A good friend and TED speaker, Melissa Marshall, talks about how bullet points are called that because they kill a presentation. And yet, if you look at many PowerPoints in many organizations, there's a lot of bullet points. And yes, I totally get that you have a lot of technical information that you might need to share. And as much as possible, using slides as the background, the wallpaper that you might not actually be, you know, you shouldn't need a laser pointer to for your PowerPoint slides to say, this one, and then this one, and then this one, right? It should just be in the background and make a point without any explanation. That's the power of visuals. That's the power of putting a Bengal tiger there, is it has an effect on people. You don't need to say, hello everyone, this is a Bengal tiger. You should be pretty surprised at its mass, right? You don't need to say any of that, it speaks for itself. Third technique that I learned in the sixth workshop that I had in this series with faculty at a university on how to make engagement easy. During the fifth session, I said, hey, some of you send me some of your content, and I actually want to design our final session based around making your content more interactive. Not just sharing ideas about it, but actually specifically taking your slide decks, your syllabuses, and make them more engaging. And so one of the things that came to mind, because often when I do something that's that applied, or I'm working or coaching or mentoring with a client, we'll co-create brand new ideas based specifically on their content. And so this one's in particular, took a list of, to be honest, relatively boring course objectives. They were like, this is what you're gonna get out of the course. And they were kind of academically worded. They were definitely not 18 to 22 year old student friendly. And so I thought to myself, what if you put up a slide, but you didn't present any of them, and you said to the group, translate these into your own language. Specifically, choose one of these seven that's on the PowerPoint, and translate it into your own language. And it was really cool. I actually did this with faculty. And so one of the course objectives was something like, bolster your communication with stakeholders in a healthcare environment. And somebody, some faculty unmuted, this is a remote session, and unmuted and just said, help people talk to each other so they don't sound like Neanderthals. It's like, this is awesome, right? The translation of that created some laughter. It converted technical info into English, which will allow it to stick better in their brain. And so the idea here is the translations technique. You put any content that you have up on a screen and you invite people to translate it. You invite people to put it into their own words, to reframe it, to rephrase it. You can go even further with this to say, here's technical information. Can you come up with a metaphor to encapsulate this idea, what we're talking about? Can you share a story, come up with a story rooted in your own experience that makes this value come alive? So instead of presenting, here's a list of values, we value integrity, right? You can turn that into content that people are participating in as soon as you say, I'm not gonna talk to you about integrity. Can you just think about a story or a time or a moment at work where integrity showed up, either in a positive or a challenging lens, and share that, right? All of a sudden, this PowerPoint is a lot more interactive and less me shoving ideas down people's throats. You stuck around toward the end, so you get the fourth bonus round. Stick something on a PowerPoint that will blow somebody's mind. Whoa. I'm assuming these might be moving for you too. But in fact, it's just a piece of paper, right? Google optical illusions. There are so many really cool examples of fun optical illusions they can put up and just shift people's perspectives. You've probably seen some of these before. Here's another example. Are the lines horizontal? All of your body wants to be like, no, they're not horizontal. But indeed they are horizontal. And just creating that, asking people for an answer or what they see. May have seen the woman in the vase or the vase that looks like two people looking at each other or about to kiss or talking. So Google optical illusions, it can be a really great brain break to just mix up, re-engage people's brain and uses a PowerPoint slide. If you're a teacher, trainer, educator, running your own practice even perhaps, and wanna join me in a remote retreat to help do this better, surround yourself with some brilliant people who are designing more interactive, more engaging presentations, learning all the behind the scenes of how to do it. Check the info below, drop me a note. We'll put you on the right list to hop into the next program, workshop, or retreat that we're hosting. I'm Chad Littlefield. Have an awesome day.